Elizabeth Bowes Lyon, Queen, Queen Mother, and the nation's grandmother.
I do hope you've all enjoyed it as much as I have. God bless you all, and thank you.
This series will reveal that one of our most beloved royals was also one of the most formidable as we delve into her extraordinary life.
If you had to pick two people who had transformed the 20th century monarchy, they would probably both be called Elizabeth.
She was fierce.
Underneath this soft exterior, Elizabeth was very steely, very determined.
Charming.
Thank you so much. It's so lovely to see you.
She was witty, and there was always this exuberance and zest for life, made her just so attractive.
And ambitious.
The choice was between head and heart, and her conduct shows throughout that she chose head over heart.
In this program, we examine how Elizabeth's early life was the making of her. But was her path one of chance, or one that she forged herself?
Prince Albert seems to have been smitten from the word go. She was not quite as smitten.
She was fighting young men off left, right, and center.
Royal experts and historians reveal the stories you've never heard about the Queen Mother's early years.
Elizabeth wanted to marry David because she and her mother, Celia, were extremely ambitious.
Elizabeth was annoyed that the future king, this playboy prince, didn't find her attractive.
She rose from obscurity to become the reluctant queen. But was that really the case?
There was always something of the actress about her. I think that she quite liked the stage.
Just how did she become an icon for the royal family?
She had an eye on the ultimate prize, the crown. It was in her peripheral vision.
She was a very determined lady, and she got exactly what she wanted.
Once she embraced her role, she was there to support her king and to give the country everything that she felt she could give it.
On the 22nd of November 2001, the Queen Mother appeared before an excited crowd in Portsmouth for the recommissioning of the aircraft carrier HMS Ark Royal.
She is a wonderful ship, and I hope we'll all be very happy in her.
Despite her advanced age at 101 years old, her vibrancy and commitment to her royal duties were unwavering. However, unbeknown to the watching crowd, it would be the senior royal's final public engagement.
She was as lively as ever, looked fantastic, and gave the command,
splice the main brace.
Which went down extremely well with the Navy.
To that final appearance, she was absolutely indomitable. She really had an astonishing ability to move a crowd. There was always a ready smile for the public or for the press. She seemed to radiate warmth and empathy.
More than a century earlier, Elizabeth Bowes Lyon was born into a far different world than the one we know today.
Elizabeth was born in 1900, which of course is still the Victorian era. You've still got Victoria on the throne, very old, but still on the throne. You've got a lot of social change going on.
Britain is at its zenith as a world power. But the foundations are shaky. London was a vast city, but full of slums, but also full of palaces and the sort of grand houses where the young Elizabeth began her life.
Elizabeth was the ninth child of Lord Claude Bowes Lyon and his wife Cecilia Cavendish Benting. Growing up, Elizabeth spent the majority of her time at her family's main home, St. Paul's, a grand, stately home set within a 50-acre estate in Walden Bury, Hertfordshire. But her ancestry had its roots in Scottish royalty.
Through her father, she was descended from King Robert the Bruce. It was old aristocracy. There's nothing nouveau about the Bowes Lyons.
Her family would have been rarely regarded as middle-ranking aristocrats. They were not the grandest or the most splendid, but they had a very ancient lineage.
The family's social status was elevated in 1904 when her father inherited the prestigious Earldom of Glamis, making him the 14th Earl of Strathmore and Kinghorn. The Bowes Lyons then added to their envious list of homes the spectacular Glamis Castle in Scotland.
Glamis Castle looks like the stuff of old-fashioned fairy tales. It was somewhere where they chose to spend their summers, and it really was a magical place to grow up. Over its history, it played host to kings and queens of Scotland, and it had visitors from the English court.
With an age gap of almost a decade between Elizabeth and her elder siblings, she was closest to her younger brother David, just 2 years her junior.
They were much younger than the other children, and it was really with David that she got up to all sorts of hijinks.
Glamis Castle has an enormously high turret above the entrance, and they would drop water on guests. There's an enormous door knocker, and as guests would arrive and knock the door, they might find water dribbling on them.
But it was through her older siblings that Elizabeth would develop the charm that she would come to rely on in her adult years.
If you've got a lot of older siblings and you spend time with their friends, you kind of like rise to their level. So there are incidences of her sort of almost flirting with the brother's friends. And so she certainly learned very early on how to talk to older people.
Growing up, Elizabeth was exposed to different people, different environments, and she thrived. And in fact, her mother told her governesses to allow Elizabeth beyond a point to do what she wanted. It was an enormous amount of freedom given to this young woman.
But this freedom, coupled with her fiercely strong character, would prove divisive.
Elizabeth was a much wanted child, and she was indulged by both her parents. Elizabeth's first headmistress, Miss Bert Whistle, said that Elizabeth was the most captivating, charming, delightful child, but with an absolute will of iron, and she would not do anything she didn't want to do. She just point blank but sweetly refused. So Elizabeth showed from a very early age a steeliness allied to a charm that were really very unusual.
As Elizabeth entered her teenage years, and with the marriage of her eldest sister Mary in 1910, her own focus turned toward how best to land herself the perfect husband. But her entire world was about to be irreversibly altered when in 1914 the country was plunged into a world war.
She might have expected within the next couple of years to have the same sort of life as her older sister, but in fact that was cut short completely.
War. War. It seemed as though the whole earth had gone mad with the spirit of bloodlust.
With Elizabeth's life on hold, she suddenly faced an uncertain future. As the nation rallied round to support the war effort, Elizabeth's family volunteered their home, Glamis Castle, to be used as a hospital for wounded soldiers.
I think the fact that the Bowes Lyons volunteered and were accepted to turn their house into a convalescence hospital is an indication of their determination to be seen to be patriotic. It was important for those with wealth to be seen to be doing things for the war effort.
Aristocratic people almost fight each other to be the one who is going to run the hospital for recuperation of wounded soldiers.
And the future queen was very eager to do her bit. Although too young to work as a nurse, Elizabeth assisted with caring for the patients alongside her mother and elder sister Rosie.
It was very much Elizabeth's role as the young daughter to keep everybody happy, to keep spirits up, to go and get cigarettes for the troops, to keep their morale up, to keep them entertained. So she learnt very, very early on to deal with all sorts of different people, and she certainly was able to exercise her charm on the wounded soldiers with whom she was sharing Glamis Castle.
It's the same Elizabeth who has a wonderful common touch. She can relate to those who are socially at her level, but much more importantly, to the man on the street and the common soldier.
But the Bowes-Lyon family did not pass through the First World War without loss. Tragedy struck in 1915 when Elizabeth's older brother Fergus was killed in action at the Battle of Loo.
That was an unimaginable sorrow for the family, and Elizabeth was instrumental in supporting her mother through that. But then a little while after that, another beloved brother, Michael, was reported missing in action. And this seemed like an unimaginable double tragedy for the family. In fact, 3 weeks later, Michael was reported to be in a prisoner of war camp and he survived the war. But it brings home the fact that Elizabeth was suffering in the same way as millions of ordinary families across the land were suffering.
The carnage of blood and death, which was to continue through four awful years, to cost 5 million lives. Price of it all, the little white crosses that tell the true story of every war that was ever fought.
It was a great leveler of the First World War, and I think that was very, very powerful for everybody of that generation.
The tragic events of the war were turning a teenage Elizabeth into a mature young woman. But in 1916, just a year after the death of her brother Fergus, her resilience would be put to the test once more when a devastating fire broke out in Glamis Castle.
She appears to take charge and be giving people instructions about everything from what to rescue and what to where to put ladders and where to put water and what have you. It is that sort of assumption that because of her background, her breeding, her confidence, she will be able to take charge and make things happen.
Like many young aristocratic women of the time, and with the war at last over, attention finally turned to her all-important debut into society.
Debutantes hadn't been presented at court during the war. All of that had been on hold. But now it really was Elizabeth's turn.
And there is, you know, a lot of anxiety about making a good match. And of course, the war has disturbed it all. Very many young men have died in the war. And so there is a sort of sense of anxiety about what will a young girl like Elizabeth's future be.
And it wouldn't have just been Elizabeth feeling the pressure.
For Elizabeth Bowes-Lyon's mother, a successful debut for her daughters was absolutely key, because the sole aim in life at this time was to have a really good marriage. And of course, that depended on how successful your coming out was.
In 1919, Elizabeth was presented at the court of King George V and Queen Mary as an eligible debutante. After developing her charm during the war, Elizabeth was determined to make a name for herself on the aristocratic scene.
Much is made of this upper-class ritual of coming out. So all the beautiful young women of that generation meet all the handsome young men of that generation. And Elizabeth circulates in society at parties. And although she was not particularly tall, she was striking looking, lovely, lovely deep blue eyes. She had the most charming manners, wonderful smile, very easy, lively intellect.
She quickly plunged into a tremendously active and enchanting social life. And she had a series of beaux who were interested in her.
But it wasn't just potential suitors whose heads were turning. Elizabeth had caught the eye of Queen Mary herself, who saw the young lady as the perfect match for one of her sons.
Queen Mary would have known Elizabeth, but she wanted to find out more. And I think she recognised in Elizabeth, certainly not a kindred spirit, but someone who was a mixture of warmth, but also a sort of toughness and had potential.
But which of Queen Mary's eligible sons would suit Elizabeth best? Would it be the famously handsome playboy Prince of Wales, the future King Edward VIII? Or his shyer younger brother Albert, the Duke of York, known to his family as Bertie?
Queen Mary took this very seriously because for her it was very important. The choice of her sons about who to marry could have enormous implications for what happened to the royal family.
At a high society dance in 1920, Elizabeth made a royal encounter that would change the course of history forever after a mutual friend introduced her to the King's second eldest son, Prince Albert, the Duke of York.
Prince Albert, Bertie as he was known, seems to have been smitten from the word go. I think there are lots of indications that she was not quite as smitten as he was, that she had one or two other beaus, that she was weighing up, but he seems to have gone home, told his mother this was the woman that he was going to marry or he wasn't marrying at all.
She referred to him, to her friends, as the dear Duke, which doesn't imply that she was wildly attracted to him, but he was persistent.
Bertie, who suffered from a number of problems growing up, he was shy, he stammered. When he first met Elizabeth Bowes-Lyon, he saw something in her that he felt would help him get through life. He recognized in her these qualities of quiet support and devotion and loyalty.
After a year of patient courtship, Prince Albert decided to make clear his feelings for Elizabeth and asked for her hand in marriage. But the proposal did not go according to plan.
She turned him down, I think largely because he was so shy and had such a terrible stammer that he got somebody else to propose to her on his behalf. Partly she turned him down for that reason, but on the other hand, I think she realised that the implications were terrifying because, as she put it herself, she would never be able to say what she felt about this.
It wasn't so much a slight against Bertie, it was more the idea of taking on the entire institution, because you don't just marry the man, you marry the royal family and by extension you marry the nation. And that would have been a very daunting prospect for a young girl of 20, 21 to give up everything that she stood for and everything that she was in order to fulfill what was required as a member of the royal family.
She's a modern woman who wants to make her own mind up. She doesn't want an arranged marriage.
A strong-willed Elizabeth had rejected the prince's offer of marriage out of fear of a royal life. Or was it a fear of life with the wrong man? Could there have been other love interests standing in Bertie's way?
As the daughter of an earl, Elizabeth was already surrounded by a veritable who's who of the finest society men on offer. She had legions of proposals for marriage. She was kind of fighting young men off left, right and centre.
One such love interest was even a member of the Duke of York's own staff, his senior attendant, Captain James Stuart.
James was actually the equerry to the Duke of York, and she'd met him at a party which the Duke of York was also attending.
James Stuart is the person that she might possibly have married amongst all of them.
She was always quite calculating, I think, and ambitious, because ambition for the best marriage you could possibly have had been so driven into her as a girl. Don't choose an earl's son when you can have a king's son.
Her heart lay with Jamie Stuart, but her ambition and her passion for worldly success and a truly splendid way of life. The choice was between head and heart, and her conduct shows throughout that she chose head over heart.
Elizabeth weighed up her options. Would it be a normal life with Captain James Stuart or a royal life with Bertie? But before she had the chance to choose, the decision was taken out of her hands as higher powers conspire to make sure the prince got his girl.
Queen Mary organized for Jamie Stuart to be offered a job in the oil industry in Oklahoma. This is in the early 1920s, when, I mean, you know, a trip to Paris was a huge deal, much less across the Atlantic and to Oklahoma, which in those days was the middle of nowhere.
If Queen Mary had intervened with the budding relationship between Elizabeth and James Stuart, why was she so fixated on the lesser-known daughter of a Scottish earl?
Elizabeth seems to have made a very good impression on Queen Mary.
who was obviously trying to marry off her sons. At the end of the First World War, marrying somebody who was English, maybe not marrying into the rather fragile and problematic royal families of Europe, was a better way forward.
It was deemed very important to show that the British royal family was entirely British, so they needed to wipe away any taint that they were German. What King George and Queen Mary wanted for their sons, both Edward and Bertie, they wanted them to marry beautiful English roses who came from good aristocratic English families.
And what of Bertie's handsome older brother, the King and Queen's eldest son, Prince Edward? Edward's reluctance to settle down had long been raising eyebrows behind palace doors. Newspapers had even alluded to a connection between the dashing Prince of Wales and the highly popular society girl, Lady Elizabeth Bowes Lyon.
Elizabeth wanted to marry David because she and her mother, Celia, were extremely ambitious. And she met David, who was extremely attractive, charming, etc. He was the golden boy of the world. And she effectively set her cap for him. But he was never interested in Elizabeth. She was everything he did not want in a woman. She was old-fashioned. She was relatively rotund. He liked them svelte, sleek, slim, and snappy.
Elizabeth wouldn't have appealed, nor her warmth. She wasn't dangerous. She was too safe. She was like a comfortable sofa, and he didn't want that. Elizabeth probably was annoyed that the future king, this playboy prince, didn't find her attractive. I think she always hoped that her charms, remember, she was very good at these balls and dances. She could charm anyone, but she couldn't charm the Prince of Wales. And I think, in a way, she always held that against him.
Edward's younger brother, Prince Albert, however, was seemingly still set on Elizabeth and continued in his pursuit of her. He proposed a second time, still with no success. But Elizabeth's reluctance only served to motivate him more.
For Elizabeth to turn down a prince does seem extraordinary, but she was quite steely. Strategically, it was a good thing to do because the fact that she refused him changed everything. It spurred him on. It made him even more determined. And I think Elizabeth, she was very strategic. I think she knew that would happen.
But Elizabeth could not keep toying with the prince forever. Pressure mounted on her to make a decision.
Bertie turns up at St. Paul's Wardenbury and apparently repeatedly asks through the weekend if Elizabeth will marry him. And eventually on the Sunday evening, she says yes.
In January 1923, Lady Elizabeth Bowes Lyon and Prince Albert announced their engagement. Elizabeth's fate was seemingly set to be the Duchess of York. But one wrong move from Elizabeth could still see her lose everything.
The king was absolutely furious that the public should get this glimpse into the royal family that made the royal family's private lives momentarily public.
They considered it vulgar. They considered it crass. They considered it just dreadful.
At the start of 1926, Elizabeth Bowes Lyon was preparing to marry the second in line to the throne. But shortly before the big day, she nearly blew it with her in-laws when she gave a gushing interview to a newspaper journalist.
She talked about how blissfully happy she was, how she didn't have her engagement ring yet, but she'd seen one that she really liked, and she described what it was that she loved about it. It really was a very charming interview where we got to see her personality and we got to see that joie de vivre that she was so well known for. But of course, the royal family didn't talk to reporters back then.
The king, George V, was absolutely furious that the public should get this glimpse into the royal family that made the royal family's private lives momentarily public. He hated that. Queen Mary hated it too.
They considered it vulgar. They considered it crass. They considered it just dreadful.
So she learned, Elizabeth, from that early experience, to retain a bit of distance, to retain a bit of mystery and mystique.
But it seemed that the interview worked in Elizabeth's favour because it gave the British people a glimpse of the girl behind the grand title, and they loved it. Elizabeth and Bertie's ceremony was one of the first royal weddings to be held at Westminster Abbey, a place normally used to crown kings and queens.
Up until the 1920s, royal weddings had really been private affairs conducted behind palace walls in private chapels. When it came to Bertie's wedding, he was the first son of a king to get married at Westminster Abbey.
Britain had, in fact, the largest empire after the First World War. And the wedding was big news, seemingly everywhere.
To have this young couple who personified the hope of the future was a very important part of how the royal family was going to link into this popularity of the crowds of ordinary people in England who looked up to them to be the perfect family, the idealized family.
The human side Elizabeth had shown when she gave that unguarded newspaper interview continued on her wedding day, when she herself decided to put her bouquet on the grave of the unknown warrior.
So the unknown warrior was an anonymous soldier from the Western Front whose body was brought with great ceremonial and buried by the great west door at Westminster Abbey in 1920.
I think in the early days, she was very eager to curry favour with the royal family. But I think this act on her part was completely spontaneous, totally heartfelt.
And the unknown warrior, I suppose, could have been a metaphor for her dead brother Fergus, for the suffering of her family, and something that every royal bride since has done when they married at the Abbey.
Elizabeth's debutante days were firmly in the past, as she had to adapt quickly to her new life as Duchess of York.
Elizabeth very quickly realised that the life she'd led before her marriage had to come to an end. Rather than being part of the roaring 20s, where people danced all night and drank and women suddenly wore short skirts and smoked cigarettes, she suddenly had to carry out royal duties.
I think she was a woman with a mission. I think just an aristocratic life in the country wouldn't have been enough for her. I think she was a woman of quite advanced social ideas.
Her husband, Bertie, was shy and reticent and suffered from a terrible stammer. So she realised that it would be her who would have to take a leading role in this family dynamic.
Despite having no formal training for such a public role, confident Elizabeth seemed to relish her new duties, representing the King and Queen on engagements across the British Empire.
She was remarkably good at it from an early day. I think she realised that the one thing that the senior members of the royal family pretty much never did, Queen Mary and George V, they never smiled. It was central to the public perception of Elizabeth. She always smiled.
I think that she had all the gifts for a public figure. There was always something of the actress about her. I think that she quite liked the stage. I think that marrying Bertie was the making of Bertie, but it was the making of Elizabeth, and it was fantastic for 20th century Britain.
She loved the attention. She loved it. Princess Mary, who her sister-in-law, used to say that very few people loved attention more than Elizabeth.
But as Elizabeth charmed the public and politicians, there was one thing missing from the first few years of their marriage: children.
of course, a royal duchess, his first duty is to produce a baby. So there was always speculation as to why they hadn't immediately produced a child. I think partly Elizabeth was getting used to her role, but in 1926, they did produce a daughter, and George and Mary were absolutely thrilled with this. And then there was a long gap before their second child, Margaret.
The arrival of the little princesses came at a time when everyone had greater access to newsreels and moving images. So for the first time, people across the world felt like they were getting to know the royal children.
The most thrilled and excited child present is Princess Elizabeth, taken to the show by her parents, the Duke and Duchess of York.
Well, Elizabeth and Bertie soon became the loving, friendly face of Brand Windsor. In fact, they re-established the whole identity of the royal family. This family was seen to project all that was good and wholesome and loyal and loving.
But the lifestyles of the king's two eldest sons couldn't be more different. While Elizabeth was a poster girl for family values, the charming but wayward Prince of Wales was enjoying a playboy lifestyle, something his parents were increasingly despairing of.
He definitely had an eye for the ladies, as it would have been described at the time, and didn't seem to show any signs of marrying, and didn't seem to like women that they thought were entirely suitable.
George commented, "I think that boy's going to ruin himself before he gets to the throne." He could not see how Edward was going to knuckle down, get married, produce an heir. Increasingly, he looked to the dutiful Bertie and Elizabeth, the Duke and Duchess of York, who it seemed couldn't push a foot wrong.
But at this stage, did Elizabeth see the prospect of an even bigger role? Especially when a divorcee called Wallace Simpson entered the frame.
He was carrying on an affair with this woman who, according to Elizabeth, was brash, was a gold digger, and was clearly not suitable marriage material to be Queen of England.
As a member of the royal family, Elizabeth was used to saying exactly what she wanted to about other people. However, when it was Wallace doing the talking about her, Elizabeth didn't like it one bit.
Elizabeth dropped in one afternoon to Fort Belvedere, walked into the drawing room, and caught Wallace mocking her.
Elizabeth overheard Wallace Simpson describe her as cookie. It was a sort of insult suggesting that Elizabeth looked like a sort of fat cook.
And she hated Wallace from that moment on.
The Duchess sets free six grey pigeons carrying greetings from the ground to the King and Queen.
At the time, the prospect of Mrs. Simpson becoming future queen seemed remote, not least because she was still married to someone else.
Elizabeth was very opposed to what she saw as Wallace's total lack of understanding of what it meant to be British, and particularly what it meant to be royal and British.
Wallace did underestimate Elizabeth. She saw this sort of not very well educated, slightly fluffy, pink English aristocratic woman. And of course she was very wrong, because underneath this soft exterior, many people noted, Elizabeth was very steely, very determined.
With the Prince of Wales showing less interest in royal duties and the King's health failing, Elizabeth and Bertie took on extra engagements. But while unflappable Elizabeth flourished, Bertie's stammer meant he was struggling with public speaking.
I'm sure that we are all happy to feel that the generosity of His Majesty has set an example to all, and which has been widely followed throughout the country.
But there was a pressing reason why Elizabeth determined to get the Duke help.
Elizabeth was very conscious of the fact that in the 1930s, the royal family had not just to be seen, but heard as well, with the development of the BBC, radio, television, and the moving image.
Believe me.
You had this new medium of radio, and George V was the most fantastic radio communicator, just as actually Roosevelt becomes a master of it, and I'm afraid Hitler is a master of that.
The Queen and I have accepted with much pleasure.
So if you were a modern leader in the 1930s, you had to be able to speak both in person and on the radio.
So Elizabeth persuaded her husband to visit maverick speech therapist Lionel Logue in secret at his Harley Street clinic. With Lionel's help, Bertie found public speaking much less daunting. But at this stage, given the state of the King's health and her brother-in-law's chaotic love life, did an ambitious Elizabeth have one eye on the future?
She wanted to help Bertie in his confidence, get rid of his stammer, because it was important for him. But she had an eye on the main chance, as it were, that if she could improve Bertie sufficiently, and if David didn't marry, then the prize, the ultimate prize, the crown, might indeed be theirs. I think it was in her peripheral vision.
Even if Elizabeth did have one eye on the prize, no one could have predicted the dramatic turn of events that were about to unfold. Despite suffering from ill health for years, the death of King George V on January the 20th, 1936, sent shockwaves throughout Britain and the Empire.
It's very public. When he dies, there's huge national grief.
And so we turn the last page of this chapter of sorrow. In sadness he passes, His Majesty King George V, mourned by the whole world.
Vast numbers of people turn out to see his coffin in Westminster Hall.
You've got the new king and his brothers walking behind the cortege with the coffin on the horse-drawn carriage. So to the world looking on, it all looks, you know, like there isn't, you know, this is just what we would expect.
The Queen, in her heavy mourning, mounts the steps.
The new king will ascend the throne, and beneath that apparently still surface, absolute chaos, turmoil.
While Elizabeth and her daughters were very publicly supporting Bertie, Edward's life with his secret mistress couldn't be more different. He was now on the throne, but who was more suited to the role of king?
There is no doubt that it is Bertie and Elizabeth who look like the natural successors. They look like the people who will continue his legacy.
On the outside, David was far more suitable to being king. He was seen as a modern king. He was seen as a caring and sharing king. His brother was seen as someone who was too quiet, too shy, almost too introverted. But underneath, Bertie was always going to be a much better king because he did his duty.
Edward was king, but for how long? He vowed never to give up Wallace. So was Elizabeth waiting in the wings, convinced she'd be queen? A crisis which would rock the very foundations of the monarchy now seemed unavoidable.
When Edward listened to the proclamation of himself as king, there was a shadow in the window of a woman, and that woman was Wallace Simpson.
To bless the royal prince, Edward VIII, with long and happy years to reign over us, God save the king.
So there were unbelievable rumours as to the lack of suitability of Edward VIII and how secure was the British crown going to be if Edward VIII gave it up, threw it away, as if it was something worthless. This was deeply, deeply worrying.
January 1936, and King Edward VIII embarks on a promising start to his reign. And it's clearly out with the old ways and in with the new.
When Edward assumed the throne, he did so on a wave of enthusiasm from the British public. He was immensely popular. They thought he was a man of the people.
I think there is a sense that Edward was pleased to be king and embraced it in many respects, but there wasn't a sense that he embraced any of the ridiculous level of sacrifice that would be needed in order to be a successful king at that point in time in history.
But in the autumn of 1936, the country was plunged into constitutional crisis. After the first part of Mrs. Simpson's divorce was granted, the king informed Prime Minister Stanley Baldwin that they planned to marry. But as the sovereign leader of the Church of England, the king could not marry a divorcee. Elizabeth urged Edward to choose duty over love.
Elizabeth decided that she was going to do all in her power to dissuade David from pursuing the path that he was hell-bent upon pursuing. She felt that she was saving him. He felt that she was interfering.
I think Elizabeth, despite her ambition, despite her probably concealed feelings that she might one day be queen, she still would have felt that when the crunch came, David would do his duty, and of course we know he didn't.
On the 10th of December 1936, just 11 months into his reign, Edward VIII abdicated.
Whereas, by an instrument of abdication, dated the 10th day of December instant, His Former Majesty King Edward VIII did declare his irrevocable determination to renounce the throne.
Following the abdication, Edward uses the new medium of radio to address the nation, who are now fully aware of the scandal.
But I have found it impossible to carry the heavy burden of responsibility and to discharge my duties as king as I would wish to do.
On the same day his brother abdicated, Bertie became King George VI, and Elizabeth, Queen Consort. So was this a moment she dreaded or relished?
I'm not completely convinced by this narrative of the reluctant consort. It adds to that particular sort of myth around her. People have talked about her as a sort of marshmallow with steel inside. I think she was a very determined lady, and I think she, most of the time, got exactly what she wanted.
Once she embraced her role, she was going to give it her best. And she was there to support her king and to give the country everything that she felt she could give it.
But whatever Elizabeth's feelings were, it was clear that the abdication had caused deep divisions in the country, a country that had been loyal to Edward VIII.
Considered to be a very modern king, and I think the public really gravitated to his way of doing things. By comparison, Elizabeth and Bertie represented the old guard.
Nobody could quite believe that anyone would throw all this away for a plain woman like Wallis Simpson.
Next time, the eyes of Britain and the Empire turn to the coronation of George VI and Elizabeth. But as a so-called reluctant queen, could she keep a wavering public on side? And how would Elizabeth fare during Britain's darkest hour, as another war with Germany loomed large on the horizon?
That's brand new next Saturday at 9 in The Queen Mother, War and Widowhood. On Thursday night at 10, the stark reality of living with chronic pain and what treatments are available for those 21 million who suffer in a brand new documentary, How to Live With It. Next tonight, live boxing coverage of the WBC silver middleweight title, Sam Eggington versus Carlos Molina.
Elizabeth wanted to marry David because she and her mother, Celia, were extremely ambitious.
Elizabeth was annoyed that the future king, this playboy prince, didn't find her attractive.
She rose from obscurity to become the reluctant queen. But was that really the case?
There was always something of the actress about her. I think that she quite liked the stage.
Just how did she become an icon for the royal family?
She had an eye on the ultimate prize, the crown. It was in her peripheral vision.
She was a very determined lady, and she got exactly what she wanted.
Once she embraced her role, she was there to support her king and to give the country everything that she felt she could give it.
On the 22nd of November 2001, the Queen Mother appeared before an excited crowd in Portsmouth for the recommissioning of the aircraft carrier HMS Ark Royal.
She is a wonderful ship, and I hope we'll all be very happy in her.
Despite her advanced age at 101 years old, her vibrancy and commitment to her royal duties were unwavering. However, unbeknown to the watching crowd, it would be the senior royal's final public engagement.
She was as lively as ever, looked fantastic, and gave the command,
"Splash the main brace."
Which went down extremely well with the Navy.
To that final appearance, she was absolutely endorsed.